Yes, the first time I was aware of digital historical scholarship was a meeting I had with Roy Rosenzweig many years ago. I think it was actually in the last century. And we were looking at how digital humanities, I should say, that wasn't a term back then, it was how digital technologies were affecting humanistic inquiry, particularly in research. And Roy was convinced not only that that the technology itself was going to transform the way that we do research, and he was really focused on the methodologies. In fact, the efficiencies of online searching, for example, pointing to how you could look at whole runs of newspapers because they were scanned in a way that you couldn't before, but more to the point that there was a whole new wave of creation and documentation of current history that was purely born digital, and that the historical profession really needed to think about how we capture, preserve, and interpret what is currently being created, not just things which existed or were created in the 19th century or before that, which can be transformed into a digital environment for research, but how we actually focus on current digital creation. Mm-hmm. And that would give us a very helpful insight into the powers of digital technology for communication, interpretation, and analysis. And so Roy had been working on this for a while, and then when 9/11 happened, he and his center instantly started to gather the testimonies of, you know, things of reactions to 9/11. So started to build an archive. And they were very non-prescriptive about what that archive would look like. It was whatever people wanted to send in the way of information. And I think that'll be an absolutely invaluable documentation. So my first encounter was actually what you might say digital oral history. Well, I think there are a couple of salient developments. The first is some technologies, some ways of preparing data for use and querying digital data that are really have the power to not only answer traditional questions more efficiently, but to raise entirely new questions that we haven't been able to answer before, although people have thought about answering them over time. The other is that there are new ways of expressing things. So there are sort of new analytical tools, and then there are the new forms of presentation. And I'd say one example is spatial visualization of data. So if you have historical facts which you can convert into data and you can plot them on a map, then you actually have an entirely different way of viewing historical phenomena, and you can see patterns which you didn't see before. Patterns which are, you might say, machine readable, but human beings with their eyes can't perceive. That's a really good question. I think that we don't know. And I think the only way that I can imagine it is to look at what people have done and see what the implications of that work is. And not only what historians have done and what other scholars engaged with digital technologies have done, but to actually look at the way people currently use digital technologies as a form of communication and knowledge acquisition and as a tool for thinking. And so I don't know. I know that historians love their engagement with primary resources, and we know that digital technologies enable an entirely new kind of way of engaging with these resources. If you can convert analog resources or remediate them, if you can take, you know, born digital data and manipulate it in a way that only computers can manipulate it, that's one thing. But I think another thing that I've seen, but it's hard to imagine what will happen with this over time, is what happens with the nature of discourse, which is carried online in a disembodied form. Because we know just from some initial analyses of behaviors that people exhibit when they're incarnated, I shouldn't say incarnated, when they are represented as avatars, that their behaviors in social situations change quite differently, and that they can actually achieve abilities that they don't have in their real world. So I'm thinking that looking at the way people engage in communication through technologies will tell us a lot about how scholars can reimagine stories from the past, which they can't do now just by a lot of interpolation from textual documents. But I don't know what that means. I say I think this is significant, but I don't know in what way. We'll just have to try and see. I don't think we can just come up with some model that we try to achieve. I think we actually have to try to work in small steps, because it's really a lot better to try something and learn from it and move on rather than try and build a perfect model that you want to implement. Because by the time you start to implement it, at the rate of innovation with technology and the people's, more importantly, people's adaptation to technologies, that when you try to implement a perfect model over 5 years, you find yourself working with an obsolete model by year two and trying to play catch up after that. Well, I know this is somewhat heretical, but I don't place nearly as much significance in tools as some people do. I actually think that the tools will continue to change, that a lot of the tools that people are building are way overdetermined by what they already know their interpretive program is. I'm much more in favor of spending most of our time right now in preparing the primary sources of historical research in all formats for use, and really agnostic use, by a large number of tools. So my emphasis and my thinking has been much more about how we prepare those resources for use by any number of tools than what has been seen in a lot of early digital historical and certainly digital humanities scholarship, which are tools to do specific interpretive operations on data. And I think without knowing it, sometimes we've developed tools in which our heuristic and our anticipated interpretation is already built into the tool. So I'm actually a lot less interested in tools than many people who are working in digital humanities now. But see, that's what you're saying is seeing history, and that's not something that we've been able to do through text usually. It takes an act of the imagination, where we can sort of close our eyes and visualize something and try to recreate in our minds what the look and feel and smell of an historical time, an historical event was. But there is a way now that you can actually, I guess, plot data, whether the data are words or whether they're geospatial locations or whatever, but you can actually create these visualizations that show you in one two-dimensional image something that you could never see before. The answer to that is yes and no. The question of the need for peer review doesn't change at all. I think how peer review is constructed is a purely social convention. I should say that it's a social act. It's been conventionalized, and scholars have inherited the conventions of peer review attached to print, either monographic review or journal article review or a promotion and tenure portfolio review. I think the procedures and the mechanisms for that change, and I think because it means that we come up with different conventions, different ways of implementing it, it looks like something quite different. But the benchmarks of excellence will never change. And the purpose of peer review is to sift through the abundance of really good scholarship to allow people to know with confidence what we think is excellent scholarship that is the most important to attend to. That if you have a limited amount of time to learn about this particular field or to keep up with your field, which is a fact of life, then you know the first things you need to attend to and then the second and third order things. So I think the goals of peer review don't change at all. I think that peer review, and in terms of whether it's open or closed, double blind or open, is something that, although it's fraught with a lot of profound ethical issues, it can't be solved one way for all communities. There are some fields of history which are so large, with so many players, that double blind reviews are actually possible. I myself train in a field with a handful of people across the globe. And so we always employed double-blind review, but it was a fiction because there were only a few people who were qualified to do it. And so it actually worked against the advancement of the field in the sense that I shouldn't say against the field in a broad, as a broad sweeping statement, but that it was so inflected by the force of certain personalities. They were transparent, but were not accountable because double blind was supposed to be operative. So I think in an environment sometimes called Web 2.0, sometimes called social media, sometimes called read-write, that it's best to perform repeated experiments with closed double-blind review and open review, and a kind of in-between where it's open, but it's open among a community that are invited. That is, the reviewers have names attached, and it's an open discourse of review. It's not open to everybody, but it's open to a group of invited scholars to have an open discussion about something. So I don't think that we really know the shape of peer review. We've been acculturated into a regime that was well-crafted, took hundreds of years to develop, and a lot of it came to us as implicit knowledge. And one of the things that I find absolutely thrilling about this moment is that our, you know, sort of implicit knowledge is not good for very much anymore. We have to make explicit what it is that our methodologies are. It was the other early encounter I had with digital humanities or digital history with Roy was the conviction that we had to engage with these technologies if for no other reason that it made us re-examine our core assumptions about the methodologies that we employ. And it's actually rare that a generational scholar gets to examine the very basic assumptions of their discipline. It's actually quite rare. And we're at this incredible moment in which if we try to elide any of those, then we're being intellectually lazy, let's say. We can't quite get around the really big issues of what the core methodologies are that really matter. So I think that, you know, there's something else about different levels of scholarship which we need to be clear about moving ahead. There's a kind of scholarship which everyone acknowledges as leading the field, and it could be in monograph form or journal form or a review form, but there are moments when a scholar says something in some form which actually changes the conversation. And it often results in the emergence of a field. For example, there was a moment when a couple of people whose names we know were saying something about American history that gave birth to a kind of environmental history movement. Because of the way that we looked at the same resources we had, this was before the print regime was even touched by any new technologies. That was such a moment. There's also a lot of scholarship, which is what we're taught we should do as graduate students, which is the kind that fills in a lot of information. You know, this fills a need, but it doesn't change the conversation. And they're both incredibly valuable. And I think we need to re-engage as a community about the ethics involved in reviewing those types of scholarship and the tendency we get into to overvalue one over the other. And so how do we achieve a balance between the many different kinds of scholarship that we need, the kind that has the charismatic star power, and the kind that is the bread and butter of the field. And I think that that's something which is very much at risk at this moment.